Hello, Stephen.
Hi, how are you?
Very good. Stephen Budd, first of all, thank you ever so much for joining our show. It's a real privilege. Your pedigree in music, everything that you've done, the bands you've worked with, the work you've done championing music and championing music in Africa is just an absolute pleasure. So, Stephen, can I ask you a question? Where does the Stephen Budd story begin? Give us a sense of Stephen Budd past before we go into all the kind of the present and the future.
Gosh, well, I grew up in sort of the outskirts of South London in the 60s, and sort of started my musical career very early on by sort of going out and helping local DJs load their stuff up onto their trucks. And there was a guy a few doors down who had a PA system, and I used to go and help him set up the PA system and do things like that and play in a band with him. And then all of a sudden, sort of punk happened, and we found ourselves doing, roadieing for punk bands and things like that. So early on, I'm of that age now. I'm in my 60s now, but it was pretty special to sort of be there during the period, sort of like 1977, 1978, and going and roadieing for some of those punk bands, like X-Ray Specs and a whole bunch of Generation X people like that. But my very first paid gig was as a roadie for Motorhead.
Good Lord, for Lemmy and
Predated that just a little bit. That was in 75, and it was at their very first gig, which was at the Winning Post pub in Twickenham. And in fact, the night before, they kind of had some kind of jam that we did at the Roundhouse with the Pink Fairies and stuff. So you have to imagine me as a
longer haired.
long haired 15, hair down to here, 15-year-old, and with my fingers in the ear in my ears under the stage, plugging in plug boards as Lemmy bounced around on top of the stage. So
Oh,
that was.
fantastic. Well, look, I think we've a bit of a tradition here that we pick a song to accompany each segment of the interview. So I think we're going to kick off straight away with a song. Now, we've asked you to pick three songs. What's your first song you've picked and why? We're going to play that for 90 seconds, then we're going to come back and dig into those kind of from the Roundhouse to where you are today. So what's the first song to get us underway, Stephen?
Oh gosh, well, what a question. I actually think it ought to be Ball of Confusion by The Temptations. That was the first 7-inch single I ever bought with my own pocket money. And then I became fairly obsessive about Motown. And the thing about Ball of Confusion is the lyrics of that song are absolutely as relevant today as they were in 1970 or 71, whenever it came out. So that would be my first choice.
Brilliant. Well, cue Ball of Confusion. Let's go.
People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin. Run, 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 but so they have. Talking about love now, brother, is a preacher. And it seems nobody's interested in learning from the teacher. Listen to me, will you please? Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, occupation, humiliation, obligation to our nation.
Ball of confusion.
That's what the world is today. Sell the pills at an all-time high.
Say it.
The heads in the sky,
set
it aflame in the summertime,
and all the people.
Evolution, revolution, got control of sound. So, children like it's to the moon, kids growing up too soon. Politicians send more taxes, we'll solve everything.
Stephen, wow. And as relevant today as it ever was. And Stephen, I'm now, you know, we kicked off 1975, you know, I thought the Pixies and the Roundhouse and the Motorhead. But talk it, just share with us the part of your career when there was you managing bands and then there's an awakening or the work that you've done philanthropically, and just share with our audience those kind of projects and how you got involved in those projects.
Are you talking about the sort of more socially conscious
projects? More socially conscious ones.
Well, I mean, gosh, I've been managing all sorts of bands over a number of years, record producers and songwriters. That was my whole career. You know, I'd managed bands like Magic Numbers, Gang of Four, Heaven 17, who I think you know, and various others. But I had been working with, and I'd sold my management company to a company called Channelfly, and we owned a few live music venues, the Barfly music venues, which were dotted around the UK. And in early 2004, I was a director of that business, and I had a bit of a floating role. I was looking after the management side, managing the artists, but I was also kind of like trying to bring the different strands of the business together. They had a lot of different strands in that business. And I was searching around in my mind for a project that would bring everybody so that we could actually work on something together. And it was a time of the Iraq War. And I just had recently become a father. And well, not that recently, my first child was 5 years old. And, you know, one day I had a sort of epiphany type experience when I saw a video of some kids playing with live munitions in Iraq. And I'm sitting there on the sofa with my daughter watching a 5-year-old playing with live hand grenades. And I'm going, it just went kapow in my brain. And I thought, well, we've got to do something around, you know, what's going on at the moment. And I reached out to War Child and got them in. And I know you've got conversations going on with them too. And I got War Child in for a conversation. And I came up with an idea, which was that we would, at the Barflies, see if we could put on some of the biggest artists on the planet playing in some of the smallest venues on the planet. And the idea is, you know, you think that's great, but I mean, you know, the Barfly only holds 200 people, you know, even the big one only held 300. So you're thinking, well, how's that going to make any money? Because that's not, even if you charge £50 a ticket, £100, it's not really a lot of money. And in the bath one day, I came up with this idea of doing the tickets as lottery tickets. And that was the kind of breakthrough moment. I went, oh yeah, you can sell
fans buy a ticket and there's a lottery to get in.
Yeah, you can sell those at £3, £4, £5 lottery tickets. People don't mind if they don't get the ticket, but if they do win the ticket, it's the Willy Wonka ticket, and they get to see the gig of their life. So then I started trying to convince artists, and it took me a good 6 months before anybody would agree to say yes. The first person to say yes was David Gray. In fact, it was his manager who said yes when I pinned him up against the wall at the Inner City conference in Manchester. And he said, yeah, we're going to do this. And then all of a sudden, the ball sort of...
Once you've got one, it's a rolling effect.
And in that first year, we had... We called it Passport Back to the Bars. And the idea was that you had to show a passport when you came in because you couldn't trade the tickets. And you were lucky enough to have a passport, whereas the kids in Iraq obviously couldn't get out of their situation, but you could fly wherever you want because you've got a passport. So that was the idea of calling it that. And we did that. And in the first year we had, oh gosh, Travis, The Cure, Elbow, Amy Winehouse, The Sugar Babes. Oh, you know, everybody, Craig David, David Gray, everybody was involved.
Children are always the victims of war, whichever side they're on. They're because they're orphaned or they have their homes destroyed. Sometimes they have everybody around them killed. And somebody has to go in and, I think, help them start to live again. Can you imagine what some of these kids have to go through? I think it's horrific. And I'm so glad there is a foundation like War Child who's operating today who can do something about it.
There is something amazing about the UK music industry and its philanthropic nature, and when there's a call to action, whether that's from Live Aid or Band Aid or Walk Back to the Bar, it just really strikes a resonance, particularly with UK acts. Why do you think that is, Stephen?
Well, you know, I think that fundamentally musicians are good-hearted people. You know, they may have all sorts of other issues going on and they may be egomaniacs, but fundamentally their souls, generally speaking, are in the right place. You very rarely see any sort of really, you know, nasty musicians, you know, with one or two notable exceptions. However, you know, they want to do something, they want to contribute something, and often they're inundated with requests. You know, I mean, any major musician manager will tell you that they get four or five requests a day to do things, and it's absolutely impossible for them to do everything. The beauty of this was it was something very small. It wasn't going to cannibalize their ticket sales, so they suddenly weren't going to have to go and play an O2 or an Albert Hall or something and then lose a whole bunch of ticket sales. It was merely, look, can you do this as a warm-up gig for a tour, or can you do it as an acoustic, or can you do it? It wasn't really a massive commitment, but the money that it could raise was a significant contribution. And so present people with something simple that they can do that's not overwhelming, that's not going to take up a lot of time. You know, that was something that occurred to me, and it felt right, and it worked. So we started that, we did that for a couple of years, and then we brought it back with War Child for the 10th anniversary in conjunction with Brits Week. So it became the Brits Week series of concerts. It was called Passport. We called it Passport to Brits Week, and then it became just Brits Week. And then, you know, a whole range of enormous artists played it over the last few years. I'm not involved any longer. I moved on about three years ago, I think, and went into and brought that idea and took that idea to other quarters. For instance, did it with Amnesty International for their Refugee Week, and that was a link up with So Far Sounds, and we did a 200 shows on the same day around the globe in people's houses, filmed with everybody from Ed Sheeran downwards, and yeah, we can show you a clip of that.
God, yeah, I'd love to see that. I am chuckling to myself here. I said there's this real DIY punk ethic inside you as well. It's kind of, we can do this. It's like, you know, nothing's, I can jump on the stage and play the three chords and the guitar. Or, yeah, sure, we can put on this. I'm sure if we ask them persuade or pin them up against the wall, they'd say yes. I'd love you to share your second song with us, Stephen. We'll share the second song and then we'll come back and talk about Amnesty and the more recent work you're working on. So what's the second song that you've picked, Stephen?
Well, I was thinking about all of the songs that I've been involved with one way or another, and one that came up that always sticks with me that I'm very, very happy to go to my grave as some kind of... yeah, he was involved with this song, which is, I managed the songwriter and put people together around this, was the New Radicals, You Get What You Give. And that's something that really, you know, touches my heart still to this day. And again, is as relevant as anything.
And do you know what? I'm the father of three lads, and my youngest 17-year-old loves that tune as well. So still finding new audience and stuff. It's great. Just what a brilliant song. So New Angles, you have what you give. Let's go.
Talk, 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 talk
great tune. Were you involved in that, Stephen? Stephen, we have to talk about that record. What an amazing... Tell us how all that came about. So,
Well, I managed an American songwriter who we're still very good friends, Rick Knowles, who was initially famous. I got involved with him after he'd been writing for Belinda Carlisle, and he wrote all those wonderful Belinda Carlisle hits. And he'd hooked up with the lead singer of the New Radicals, Greg Alexander. In fact, he discovered Greg playing in a bar one day. And they worked together on a first album that never got released. But then we encouraged the writing sessions between them. And over a period of a couple of years, they wrote songs like Life is a Roller Coaster for Ronan Keating and people like that. Really kind of uplifting, great, sort of powerful pop songs. And of course, Greg had his own band with him and his girlfriend. And Rick one day played me down the phone this song that they'd written, and it just started off with that piano chord, so the dang, 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 dang. And all of a sudden, I was transported. This is one of the greatest rock songs, rock pop songs that I've ever heard. And you know that moment, and I had that moment, which I've only had maybe three or four times in my career, when I've heard a song for the first time and absolutely knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that it was a worldwide smash record. You know, I've heard a million records that I've loved and been involved with making, and like you hope they're going to be hits, but this one was one of the very few where you went, yeah,
that's the one.
It's a smash. You know, funny enough, Life is a Roller Coaster was like that. When we heard the demo of Life is a Roller Coaster, which Greg had recorded drunk, lying on the sofa, drinking beers with a really out of key vocal. And I went, you know, that's a number one record.
And I'm bottom of a kind of conversational lyric as well, which I really enjoy too. Super, really, really brilliant stuff. Brilliant. So in this part of the interview, Stephen, I want to explore kind of more recent times too, but also touch on Greenpeace and all the other activities you're involved with. Share that with our audience. Share these exciting projects you're working on. And so where is the Stephen Budd story today?
Okay, well, these days I do several things. I'm managing a couple of artists. So I manage a band called Nubian Twist, who are kind of coming from that London jazz scene, mixed with a bit of Afrobeat. They're doing pretty well. They would have cleaned up this summer at festivals if festivals had been happening, but there we are. They're booked for a bunch of festivals at the end of the summer that I'm just hoping are not going to be cancelled. We will know about these things in the next few weeks, I'm guessing. So I'm looking after them. I did a 3-year stint as chairman of the Music Managers Forum, which is like the trade association for music managers. I work with Cooking Vinyl Records, A&Ring for them. So I signed things. They're very lucky to work with one of the best independent companies on the planet. And they tend to sign more things that have been established in the past and just need a reorientation, but also some new projects. So I'm doing that. And I'm working on a couple of other, you know, sort of more charitable projects. You mentioned Abed. I work with him on Palestine Music Expo and Martin Goldschmidt as well, and help those guys along, which is a wonderful project. And then I do Africa Express with Damon Albarn. And I've been doing that since we started it. Myself, Ian Birrell, and Damon in 2006. And since then, you know, we've taken many groups of wonderful international musicians out to places like the Congo, Ethiopia, Mali. A couple of years ago, we went to South Africa and took 20 musicians down there and hooked up with 20 South African musicians and made an album which is fantastic as a kind of crossover album of what's coming out of South Africa now, together with people like Nick Zinner from the Yeah Yeah Yeahs and Getz and a whole variety of people.
I remember years ago, just and the kind of sound of Soweto, and there were so many things coming out of Africa music-wise. And I even remember Paul Simon throwing a light on that too, with Gracelander was...
Well, I mean, that's right. I mean, he sort of, you know, broke the cultural boycott to do it, but probably rightly he broke the cultural boycott because it was, it brought South African music to the world. But we wanted to take African music out of the world music box that had been put in and give it a more, you know, contemporary audience. And the way that we figured to do that was by getting African musicians to collaborate with famous Western musicians. Because if you're a fan of Beyoncé, for instance, and you see that she's working with somebody, a new artist, and you've never heard of that artist, if you're a fan, you're going to want to find out about that artist. And that was the effect that we wanted to create through Africa Express. So we've been putting on shows in the UK, across Europe, and in Africa, where we get everybody to collaborate together. We do festivals like Glastonbury. We did a historic show at Glastonbury on the Park Stage, Roskilde. And then in 2012, we took 80 musicians and put them on a train and took them around the UK for 7 days. Paul McCartney, John Paul Jones from Led Zeppelin, the Libertines, the Noisettes, New Order, but with Bubba Marl, Amadou and Mariam, Fatoumata Diawara.
Amadou and Mariam, the Mali, that album is absolutely fabulous. Were you responsible? I think you were probably responsible for Shining a Light, and that's how I probably know.
Well, Marc Antoine, who was my partner, I managed a band called Songhoi Blues that we discovered in Mali on an Africa Express trip. And Marc Antoine, who's deceased now, but he was my partner. He was the guy who managed Amadou and Mariam. And he was the guy who took us to Mali. So encouraged us to go to Mali. So we went to Mali twice on Two Africa Express. Took Brian Eno down there and a whole bunch of people. In fact, there's a clip that we can play you of the Africa Express train, which is a wonderful clip, which is worth showing you all.
Oh, we'll definitely do. We'll pause now. We'll QVT, Q clip. We'll go ahead and have a look at a clip and then we'll come back and have a continuing chat. So... to a clip. Stephen, that's absolutely amazing. So, Stephen, so tell me about current plans then for this is amazing. So, obviously, COVID has changed everything here in the landscape with lockdown, with festivals. But how has it impacted the artists you're working with in Africa and around the world?
Well, I mean, you know, I'm also involved in festivals. You know, I started up a few festivals. I started one in India called the NH7 Weekender. Again, I could show you a clip of that. And also helped start one in Korea called the DMZ Peace Train Festival. Of course, both of those festivals were cancelled. I also have one in the UK called One Fest, but we managed to run that as a virtual festival. Of course, it's not the same. So, you know, we're all crossing our fingers like crazy that the events can come back. Realistically, they're not really going to come back in full scale until next year, 22. But it's something that I live and breathe for. Live music, you know, I moved out of managing producers and everything and got... alongside parallel to managing artists, really got stuck into the whole creating live music events and stuff like that. So that's where my kind of heart lies, is standing in a muddy field watching, well, preferably.
I think it all comes back to a young fella, long haired, lifting a PA system into a venue, doesn't it? All comes back to that live experience and just
completely
doing it, doesn't it?
Completely. So, yeah, I'm doing that. I'm working on sketching out a couple of other new sort of social projects, really. One to do with vaccinations and encouraging people to get vaccinated, not just in the UK but around the globe. I can't talk too much about that yet because it hasn't crystallized, but I'm hoping that it will do shortly. And then, you know, I'm sort of open to discussing things with different people as to where I can help. PMX is Palestine Music Export, is a wonderful, wonderful project. And Abed and the team have created something extremely special there. So I'm very happy to be associated with that too.
I shared a wonderful conversation with Abed, and we're going to come back in October and do a special showcase. And I'm super. So I can't believe how quickly time has gone and how quickly time travels us. And we're going to finish on your last choice of track, Stephen. We're going to have to get you back. You know, we're going to have another interview about all these other wonderful projects. But if there's one thing you wanted to maybe highlight to our audience, one thing from all the projects and music and stuff you're involved with that you thought that you'd like to highlight for our audience, what would it be, Stephen, for people to find out more about?
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, I mean, you know, by all means, go and check Africa Express stuff out. There's lots out there on Spotify. There's lots out there on YouTube. But I'd have to say the current band that I'm working with, Nubian Twist, and their sister band, Onipa, those are the things that I'm excited about. And I think my final track would be the current Nubian Twist single, which is called Flow.
Oh, fantastic. What an appropriate... Stephen, I'm absolutely fascinated from kind of teenage punk in the Renaissance all the way through to global ambassador for music and doing good for others with music. It's an inspiring story, Stephen. I just want to thank you ever so much on behalf of myself and all of my colleagues at Ditto, from all of the folk we're working with at War Child, from about everything. You're some man from one man. And thank you very much again, Stephen. And here we go, Nubian Twist with Flo. Thank you.
Ciao.
Just feeling bubbling, got to let it flow. Forced moves feel tense, trying to learn to enjoy silence. Had to let it flow. If I stop crying.